Since today is the 97th birthday of Henry Kissinger, I thought we'd take a look at the most significant period of his life. I will be covering his entire life up until as Secretary of State in August of 1974, when President Nixon resigned and Gerald Ford took over.
Henry Kissinger was born Heinz Alfred Kissinger on May 27th, 1923. The son of school teacher Louis Kissinger and homemaker Paula Kissinger. Kissinger's brother, Walter, was born the following year. The Kissinger family fled Germany in 1938 to avoid Nazis and initially lived in England before making New York their permanent residence. Kissinger attended high school in Upper Manhattan, and while he assimilated with American culture, he would retain his German accent as a result of his youthful shyness that caused him reluctance while speaking. Kissinger later attended school at night and worked during the day at a shaving brush factory. Kissinger studied accounting at the City College of New York, where he excelled academically before his studies were interrupted upon his drafting into the U.S. Army. Kissinger received his basic training at Spartanburg, South Carolina's Camp Croft, and became a naturalized U.S. citizen at the age of 20 in June 1943. Kissinger initially was sent by the Army to study engineering in Pennsylvania before the program was canceled, and he subsequently reassigned to the 84th Infantry Division. Kissinger began teaching at the European Command Intelligence School at Camp King after being reassigned. In 1950, Kissinger received his AB degree in political science from Harvard College. Kissinger would go on to receive an MA and PhD from Harvard University in 1951 and 1954. In between serving as consultant for the Psychological Strategy Board director. 3 years later, Kissinger released the novel, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, a critique of the incumbent President Dwight D. Eisenhower's nuclear doctrine, and caused controversy for advocating for tactical nuclear weapons being used regularly to win wars. This earned him attention from Vice President Richard Nixon, who messaged him about the book. Kissinger next worked as director of the Special Studies Project of the Rockefeller Brothers Fund. Throughout the 1960s, Kissinger supported the presidential campaigns of New York Governor Nelson Rockefeller. Kissinger attended the Clare Booth Lance Party in 1967, which was his first meeting with Richard Nixon, then a former vice president and Republican presidential nominee in 1960. Nixon ran for president the following year, during which time Kissinger was working as a foreign policy advisor for Governor Rockefeller. Nixon won the nomination for development, which disappointed Kissinger until he changed his mind to being willing to do anything to help Nixon win. In the 1968 presidential election, Richard Nixon defeated Vice President Hubert Humphrey to become the 37th President of the United States. Kissinger was appointed National Security Advisor in Nixon's administration. During Nixon's second term, Kissinger would become Secretary of State. Kissinger kept Secretary of State William P. Rogers and Defense Secretary Melvin Laird out of decision-making.
You know, when I was looking at the comments Kissinger made about Nixon during the 1968 Republican primary, I'm reminded of the way Trump was treated by the Republicans during the 2016 primary, where you had all of these various members rebuking him, saying they weren't going to vote for him, they were going to vote for Hillary. I mean, just so we're clear, Kissinger said that Nixon was the most dangerous of all the men running to have as president. If that isn't an anti-endorsement, unendorsement, I don't know what is. And it was funny because you might have someone who will say, does this mean that Kissinger always just disliked Nixon and that his true feelings were the ones before Nixon won the election? And to that, I really don't know, because there was a, what, 4 or 5 month period between the Republican primary being over and the 1968 election where Nixon defeated Hubert Humphrey. So it's too complicated to say, because I would reason that people can change their minds very significantly about a person or a situation in the span of months. Was it convenient for Kissinger's career to now start thinking of Nixon as a good man who needed to be president? Yes, it was.
The Vice President Nixon wrote you a fan letter in 1958 when your sensational book, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, was published, and Clare Booth Luce arranged a meeting, brief meeting with you at her apartment in New York. But the next and second time you meet him is in the Pierre Hotel when he is president-elect and he offers you, or he appears to think he offers you, the position as his national security advisor. What do you remember of that meeting?
Well, if anyone had predicted to me or anyone, say, at the beginning of 68, that at the end of 68, I would have been appointed National Security Advisor to Richard Nixon, that would have been considered mad. I had met him, as you pointed out, Frank, for 10 seconds at a Christmas party in Claire Booth Luce's house. He was coming in as I was going out. He had written me a very friendly letter in 58 about my book, Nuclear Weapons and Foreign Policy, and I guess I answered it politely, and I'm sure I answered it politely. But for most of that period, from 58 to 68, I was the foreign policy advisor of Nelson Rockefeller, who contested the nomination, he was a competitor for the nomination in three times. And so when I was invited to meet with Nixon, he sort of reviewed the international situation with me. One of the essences of Richard Nixon was that he was very diffident in his personal relationships, and that he wanted to avoid situations in which he might be rejected. So by the end of that first meeting, I knew he wanted something, but I didn't know what. So I went back to Harvard, and a week later, John Mitchell called me up and said, "Well, are you going to take the job or not?" And I said, "What job?" And Mitchell said, "Oh my God, he screwed it up." So I was called back, and this time he offered me the job. And this is no credit to me, but I was an arrogant Harvard professor. So I said, "I've been opposing you, or at any rate, I've been on the other side for the last 10 years. I'd like to think about it." He should have told me to get lost at that point. He said, "Take a week." And the person who saved the situation was Nelson Rockefeller, who, when I told him about it the next day, said, "Has it ever occurred to you that Nixon is taking a bigger risk on you than you on him?" Which was absolutely true. But so anyway, from this, you'd say unpromising beginning.
Unlikely beginning.
From the first day that I walked into the office, Nixon didn't treat me as being on trial, he treated me as his chief advisor. And the essence of Nixon, the quality of Nixon's foreign policy was that he was a very reflective man. He would sit he had a little hideaway, or not a little, but he had a hideaway office in the executive office building in the State Department, old State Department building. And he'd sit there for hours with yellow pads, having read books or memos and thinking through the issues. And what he liked to do is to get me in and discuss how to think about these things. But at the same time, he had a great capacity to make important decisions. And I would say over those years, I think back of them to them with enormous pride. And in the book that Frank Gannon was kind enough to mention, I devote what? I go through various presidencies that I had considered. I list him together with Teddy Roosevelt as the two most seminal presidents of foreign policy in the way I believe foreign policy should be considered.
Nixon entered office with roughly 300 Americans dying in Vietnam a week amid the war's unpopularity within the United States. Kissinger was publicly critical of the attrition strategy by General William Westmoreland due to the willingness of the Vietnamese communists to accept higher casualties than the Americans so long as they could be the victor to the conflict by keeping it going. As the new National Security Advisor, Kissinger supported a potential negotiation in which the United States and North Vietnam would sign an armistice that would entail both countries removing their troops from South Vietnam and being concurrent with the Viet Cong and South Vietnamese governments forming a shared government. Kissinger sought the counsel of Vietnam experts working within the CIA, American government, and State Department, which resulted in him receiving a large volume of mixed opinions, as some stated the progress in South Vietnam, while others doubted Saigon would match the Viet Cong either militarily or politically. Kissinger passed along their commentary with his own, implying that Nixon should do what he wanted, given there was no consensus among experts.
So I really like the armistice that Kissinger initially supported of the U.S. and North Vietnam, saying, hey, we're at peace now. It's really similar to how the Korean War ended, where it technically did not formally end, but it is effectively over. The Viet Cong in South Vietnam having a shared government probably was not going to work because they were warring sides, and a lot of times you can't get both sides to have concessions, which enable them to feel as if they're actually getting some or most of what they want. So it was a really, in my opinion, good idea and something that I would prefer versus the, what, 5 full years of the war that we got under Nixon. But hey, it was a decent plan that probably needed some more checking out.
In early 1969, President Nixon initiated Operation Menu, the secret bombing of Cambodia without congressional approval. In May, the bombing became public knowledge due to a leak by New York Times journalist William M. Beecher in an article. Kissinger was angered by this, telling FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover they would destroy whoever did this. And the phones of 13 Kissinger staff members were warrantlessly tapped by the FBI. Kissinger concurrently portrayed himself as a moderate figure who wanted to remove the U.S. from Vietnam.
So Kissinger was a man of many masks, where you've got him in the background, behind the scenes, saying, we're going to destroy whoever revealed the bombing of Cambodia, Operation Menu. And then to his friends, well, I'm the, you know, just this lowly Secretary of State trying to make sure the U.S. peacefully gets out of this war. And, you know, I want to make sure we get out of Vietnam and no more people have to die. And it's crazy to think that he is so keenly aware of these two different versions of himself, the one that's in public and private. And it kind of reminds me to relate it to something else in modern politics, where Hillary was discovered to have a public position and a private position, where in the public you say something they might like or agree with, but then the people who are actually stand to lose money if these ideas are implemented, you'll say, oh, I'm not going to do it. Don't worry. This is my actual position. This is the private real me, the fake public me is the one that's saying all of the good stuff that people want to hear.
President Nixon promoted the linkage policy, which sought to make the Soviet Union cooperate with halting third world revolutions by receiving economic and nuclear concessions. The relationship being that progress in Area A was tied to progress in Area B. Kissinger had doubts about the theory, as he believed it would enable the Soviet Union to have leverage over the United States in the long term, and did not share Nixon's concerns regarding the ultimate fate of South Vietnam. In March 1969, Kissinger sent Cyrus Vance to Moscow to inform the Soviet Union that the U.S. would concede in talks on limiting the nuclear arms race if the Soviet Union persuaded North Vietnam into a diplomatic settlement favorable to the U.S. Kissinger concurrently met with Soviet Ambassador to the United States Anatoly Dobrynin, who he warned that Nixon wanted to escalate the Vietnam War. Nixon played the role of the reckless president at the end of his patience with North Vietnam, while Kissinger depicted himself as a reasonable diplomat that wanted to have better relations with the Soviet Union. Kissinger told Dobrynin during another 1969 meeting, that the train has just left the station and is now headed down the track, a warning for the Soviet Union to start pressuring North Vietnam before Nixon did something dangerous. The Soviet Union did not pressure Vietnam, and de Bruijn told Kissinger the Soviets wanted better relations with the U.S., with the Vietnam War not being a factor, effectively resulting in a failure for the linkage strategy.
So the linkage policy was actually, I think, a pretty decent idea, that your relations with us are tied to our relations with somewhere else. And it's kind of like a less articulate version of the Gulf War under the first President Bush, where you had this coalition of countries get together to go after Saddam, in the sense that it tries to link them together by saying they have shared interest. But Dobrynin did not buy into this, and by extension, the Soviet Union, because they knew they had nothing to lose, at least barring from their relations with the U.S., if they didn't bother to get involved with the Vietnam War. Because they knew however badly things went for the U.S., they weren't going to just say, well, screw the Soviet Union now, because they were too valuable.
On August 4th, 1969, Kissinger held a secret meeting with Xian Toy at the apartment of French politician Jean Saint-Denis for a peace discussion, where Kissinger's proposal for a mutual withdrawal of American and North Vietnamese forces in Saigon was rejected by Thai, and Thai's demand for a new government in Saigon was rejected by Kissinger. Kissinger opposed the Vietnamization strategy, which was supported by Defense Secretary Laird. In September, Kissinger sent a memo to Nixon advising against de-escalation, arguing that keeping American troops in Vietnam was one of their few bargaining chips. That month, Kissinger also proposed Duck Hook, which he saw as the most effective way to ensure North Vietnam acquiesced to the demands of the U.S. This was also opposed by Defense Secretary Laird. Stanley Coreau, writer of the 1983 novel Vietnam, A History, noted that Kissinger was less sensitive to public opinion than Laird, who had previously been a congressman, and advised Nixon at various times to keep the public's perception in mind. In April 1970, Nixon decided to invade Cambodia with American troops, Kissinger defending the decision when speechwriter William Sapphire noted it was against the Nixon doctrine's policy of Asian allies of the U.S. doing the fighting. Kissinger was also under pressure to resign from his Harvard friends. The largest protest against the Vietnam War ever took place during the following month, amid views that Nixon had recklessly escalated the conflict. It has been claimed by Kissinger's former aide, Roger Morris, that Kissinger, frightened by the anti-war demonstrators, compared their movement to Nazis, given his deep distrust for mass movements on either side of the political spectrum. Kissinger supported President Nixon's June 1971 decision to ban the Pentagon Papers, which, due to their leaking to the media, were dubbed by Kissinger a hemorrhage of state secrets. In March 1972, the Easter Offensive was launched by the PAVN, overrunning provinces in South Vietnam. Kissinger, at the time of the offensive's launch, planning Nixon's Moscow trip, scheduled for 2 months later. Nixon made a threat to cancel the summit with Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev in the event that the Soviet Union was not willing to pressure North Vietnam to end the Easter Offensive. While Nixon believed in severing attempts to better relations with the Soviets if they were unwilling to get involved with the Vietnam War, Kissinger viewed Nixon as massively overestimating the influence of the Soviet Union on North Vietnam, in addition to seeing the president as obsessed with Vietnam and believing that the United States' damaging relations with the Soviet Union would make the international power balance unstable. Nixon criticized Kissinger as being obsessed with securing a peace treaty and expressed regret at not bombing North Vietnam in 1970 due to his view that it would have ended the war. In early May, Nixon ordered the American Air Force to bomb Hanoi and Haiphong, and for mining to begin in North Vietnam. Both Kissinger and Nixon were relieved when the Moscow summit was not canceled by the Soviet Union in response to the bombing and mining on the part of the American government. In March 1973, Nixon delivered a speech indicating the U.S. might return to Vietnam in the event of a communist ceasefire. On December 10, 1973, Kissinger and Lê Duc Thao were awarded the Nobel Peace Prize due to their efforts in negotiating of the Paris Peace Accords. Two members of the Nobel Committee resigned in protest for the first time in the history of the Peace Prize, and it has been described as the most controversial awarding to date. Citing the Vietnam War as ongoing, Thao rejected the award, while Kissinger accepted it and donated the proceeds to children of American soldiers who had either died or been missing in action in Indochina.
So I remember very distinctively when Obama got the Nobel Peace Prize and how just completely out of the blue it was to have this relatively new president get it. And their explanation was, we believe he's going to change the future. And then his change of the future was to literally take the U.S. from 2 wars to 7. And there's actually a quote by Jimmy Dore. He said that people who get the Nobel Peace Prize usually don't try to get another one. It's a very important award. And I usually don't focus on when people get awards, but I'd say it's probably one of the top 4 times I can think of the Nobel Peace Prizes awarding of someone being important. So when Carter got it, it was significant because he's the only president who, after office, was considered to have enough accolades to receive it. And when MLK got it, he got it and was then repudiated by the FBI director in the most vicious of ways. So Kissinger's thing is really mainly significant for the 2 members that resigned. And the fact that one of the people he was awarded it with said, hey, I'm not taking this award so long as Vietnam continues, because it means nothing. And it did mean nothing. It's just a way of making significant people feel better about themselves. It's a jerk-off award.
Kissinger did not share President Nixon's interest in rapprochement with China. In April 1970, President of the Republic of China, Chiang Kai-shek's son, Chiang Ching-ku, visited Washington. Both Kissinger and Nixon pledged to never abandon Taiwan nor make compromises with Chairman of the Communist Party of China, Mao Zedong. In July and October 1971, Kissinger made trips to the People's Republic of China to meet with Premier Zhao Enlai. Zhao demanded that the U.S. recognize Taiwan as a legitimate part of China, remove American troops from Taiwan, and conclude their support for the Kuomintang regime. Kissinger conceded on removing American troops from Taiwan. Around the time of Kissinger's second trip to China, whether China should be represented in the United Nations came up for debate. Kissinger disagreed with the U.S.'s attempt to promote a compromise where both Chinese regimes would be represented in the U.N. Then U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations, George H.W. Bush, lobbied for the two Chinas formula. Kissinger criticized Bush to Nixon, saying that Bush was both too soft and lacking in sophistication for his post. The legacy of Kissinger's trips paved the way for Nixon's famous 1972 visit to China and the formalization of relations between the United States and China after 23 years of isolation and shared hostility. Although full normalization of relations with China due to the Watergate scandal and the U.S.'s choice to continue recognizing the Republic of China on Taiwan would not happen until after Nixon left office.
Ziegler is out of town, and I've talked to Terry Warren.
Yeah.
He hasn't had a single press question yet. And the line I've tentatively established, subject to your approval, is that he was talking about South Vietnamese capabilities, not any particular plans.
That's right.
And he was just
very good
talking about abstract capabilities.
Yeah, hypothetical
things.
And not about American activities.
That's right. If that's agreeable, that's what we're going to stick with.
Would you get Laird? Laird will probably be asked.
No, I got word to defense already.
How would Laird handle it then, or Hank?
Well, Laird would say
essentially
the same thing. They haven't had many queries either.
Well, what this is, Henry, it's the devilish press again, just trying to take one little old word and hypo this thing. Henry, basically, it's pretty much a defensive thing on their part. They are really must be up the wall, don't you think so?
Well, what you're feeling? Here they've been going, saying everything that we're bringing the Chinese in, that Laos would lead to a worsening of the situation.
That's right.
Now they see that that they got beaten back from Firebase 6, military activity is dropping again, just as we said it would.
Yeah.
And the China thing breaks. They're just out of their mind.
Don't you sense that in talking to
them? Oh, yeah. Well, they're just completely confused.
That's right. Well, they're off. Now, the way the line they'll probably take, it seems to me, is to come back at it in terms of saying, well, this is really just the Chinese people. I mean, this is that we'll get along with the American people and that sort of thing. But I don't think the Chi-Coms Our government will play it that way.
No, no.
I think the Chi-Com government knows that the American people can't do one damn thing for them.
They're playing for the big stakes, Mr. President.
Don't you think so?
And I've got two books full of initiatives we've taken, and if they press us, we'll just leak them all out.
Yeah. Oh, sure. They try to say that that this all happened because of their initiative and so forth, but it's really amusing to me, though, because it's while Mike is honorable, these other Democrats are not. The way they're all pandering around and now trying to run over there to China and so forth.
Yes, the problem is they never recommended any of this, Mr. President. They can say whatever they want. This is yours.
And neither did the State Department either.
That's right. I mean,
we pushed them all.
The State Department was sort of crying around with recognition, and
that's all. They were all talking about what was really what you call a tactical, abstract thing, which was really unfeasible.
Well, I showed Osborne that little note you sent me on February 1st, 69, and his mouth really dropped way open.
Yeah, yeah. It's too bad that wasn't in my handwriting. It was, but they copy it off, apparently, at that time.
Oh, it's off tape, usually.
Well, I may have dictated it.
Yeah.
I may have dictated it on the tape.
Yeah.
That's right. But but it came on with it. Was it to you from RN? Was that the way it was?
No, it's that to Kissinger from the president.
Yeah, I see. Well, that's enough.
Oh, that they know this isn't a fake.
He knows that.
Oh no, he knows we wouldn't fake then.
And it indicated that we ought to. What was that one? That was the first one.
Well, it said, "I want you to explore on a highly confidential basis how we can improve our relations with communist China, and above all, how we can establish reliable private channels to them."
Good.
I mean, it couldn't be more explicit.
Yeah,
the president.
Good.
He said, and you said, "I want no publicity whatsoever."
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That must have really killed him.
Oh, God, his mouth really dropped about 6 inches.
Because I suppose that, you see, there some of his mythology then is knocked out, and when he writes something else, he's just has to feel he's dishonest.
They know damn well that on February 1st, 69, no State Department had gotten...
This is February 69, before the State Department ever even talked to me.
That's right.
Yeah.
This was February 1st, 69.
Which is basically 10 days after we were in office.
10 days. That's right.
And I think it's very interesting that they...
No, I think on this one, sure, the Democrats are going to start yelling now. They're going to come up with 50 hot gimmicks, but we are so far ahead of...
Sure. What they're coming, what they'll come up with, Henry, is why don't we now admit them to the UN? Why don't we recognize and so forth? Well, that's all premature.
Also, Mr. President,
we don't want to let that be the debate.
That helps us with the Russian game.
I think so.
Because if the Russians see that the Democrats are more hog wild vis-a-vis China than you are...
Yeah. I hadn't thought of that, but it's true.
Then they have much less of an incentive to bring them in. They already don't trust them on the Middle East. Then if China, they also turn out to be a disaster.
True, true, true.
So I think my major worry is that if we get too eager, that the Chinese will start going back into a shell. And that's why the way you've played it, and
I agree.
That's where the Democrats
I
do damage.
I sure as hell don't expect to get eager at all with the Chinese.
Oh, no, you...
Unless the Russian thing drops, then the Chinese may want to be eager. You know what I mean?
Right.
And we will too. We can't just assume then, well, we'll wait till 1974.
Oh, no.
See,
oh, God, no.
This is one of those things where I don't believe... I think our Chinese game, Henry, should be played exactly as it's being played. Very cool and aloof, and yet the door's open. Now you walk in, kids, and it's your move.
Mr. President, I must tell you, honestly, I believe that we have a 30% chance, even if we play the Russian game, of having a high-level Chinese one next year.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well,
that may not have to wait till 70.
Well, we want to use it. We want it at the highest level, too.
That's what I mean. That's not at all excluded.
Let me say that the more I think about it, the envoy thing, if we're going to go, I think we ought to go at the highest level.
Well, I think the envoy could prepare for it.
It might, but in other words, it might take a lot of the zip out of it, too. You know what I mean? It's you just can't tell, and I don't know if there's anybody we can trust to send over there.
Right.
That's still in it.
Well, that's a bit down the road, yeah.
All right, fine.
We need a reliable channel. Right, Mr. President.
Before I ask you what working with Richard Nixon was like, we have a couple of clips from some interviews I did with him in 1983 in which he talks about what working with you was like. And the first one deals with the 2nd of May, May 2nd, 1971. He's in the Lincoln sitting room after a state dinner working. He's still in his tuxedo. You're in the Situation Room in the White House, and word comes through that the Chinese government is going to invite Nixon to China. And you have to get from the Situation Room in the basement of the West Wing to the Lincoln sitting room on the second floor of the family quarters. This is how he described it.
He must have run all the way from the Situation Room, which is about 200 yards away from the sitting room and the president's. And he said, this is the most important message between heads of government since World War II. And then he read the message. As I read it, he beamed, and the message in effect said, we'll welcome the President of the United States to meet with Zhou Enlai. And then we will also welcome Dr. Kissinger to come to prepare for the meeting. And he said, this message, he had a, with their great sense of humor and their subtlety, it ended with an interesting clause. He says, this message is somewhat different from the usual diplomatic message because it's from ahead, to ahead, through ahead. From ahead, head of state or government, Zhou Enlai. Through ahead, of course, was Yahya, Pakistan, to ahead. The message, of course, since we had no relations with China, didn't come from the Chinese. The Pakistani ambassador had delivered it to Henry Kissinger and then Kissinger to me. So it was from ahead, through ahead, to ahead.
Did Zhou Enlai putting that kind of, whatever you would call it, grace note into that message, did that have any significance, or was it just sort of representative of his mind?
No, it was, you have to remember, Nixon came into office determined to find a way to at least exchange ideas with the Chinese. But that was easier said than done, because the Chinese were in the middle of the Cultural Revolution, and they had recalled all their ambassadors from around the world. There was only one ambassador left, that was the one in Cairo, with which we didn't have diplomatic relations in the aftermath of the 67 war. So we tried various possible approaches to get a message to the Chinese. For example, when Nixon, at the state funeral of de Gaulle, there was a reception in the Elysee Palace for heads of state. And the Chinese ambassador was there. And Nixon said to me, if you can get him alone for a moment, walk up to him and tell him we want a dialogue. Well, if I had done that, he was never alone for a moment, so I couldn't deliver that message. That would have been a sensation, that a presidential assistant talks to a Chinese ambassador. But so 3 months later, we were in Pakistan, and Nixon told the Pakistan president, who he knew, and Pakistan did have diplomatic relations with China, that same thing. He wanted a dialogue with China. We also tried Romania, where Nixon was on the same trip. Actually, we went from Pakistan to Romania, thinking that maybe they would be more open to a message from a communist country. That was a mistake in the sense that if the Chinese distrusted anyone, it was a communist country. So the Chinese picked up that message from Yahya via the Pakistan president and sent that message. Actually, in his conversation with you, Nixon consolidated several messages that the Chinese had said. Everything he described happened, but in maybe two messages. Their first response was, we take this seriously because it came from ahead, through ahead, to ahead, and we want a dialogue based on the proposition that Taiwan has to go back to China. Nixon replied, we want a dialogue, but nobody can determine the agenda. So we want to talk about the things that are on our mind, and you can talk about the things that are on your mind. And out of this then crystallized a message from the Chinese, which in effect invited him to come and invited me to come for a preparatory visit. But you have to remember, this was a sensational event at that time, because very few countries recognized China at all. Would have been strong opposition in this country. Nixon did this on his own. And this is not a question you asked, but to understand Nixon's reaction, say, to the Pentagon Papers, you have to understand that we were negotiating these things with the Chinese at the same time, and we didn't want to create the impression that we were a country that couldn't keep any secrets. So anyway, this is how the dialogue evolved. But you have to understand the enormous courage for Nixon to send his personal assistant to China. The way these messages were delivered was, the Chinese wrote them out on paper, on a piece of paper, which was then delivered by a Pakistani messenger. And we typed our answers on a paper that had no watermarks on it, and unsigned. And out of this then developed my visit to China. And at the first meeting with Zhou Enlai, he called my attention to that Kansas City speech. And that was important because there were 100 or so issues between us and China. But what was important at that moment was to make sure that the two sides understood where they were going. So the philosophical and conceptual part was more important than the tactical part.
You know, the feud between the older Bush when he was a UN ambassador from the U.S., and Kissinger's really made all the more significant given what position the older Bush ends up having later on, and just the fact that I believe he's probably one of the best presidents we had on foreign policy, at least of the last century. But it was funny also because you have this belief system among people that you can't compliment a person you don't like for doing one or two decent things, and restoring relations with China was good. Notably, they were brought down by Watergate because of the continuous just cycling of things that happened, where we didn't really get them fully restored on the technicality until Carter, who, you know, everybody likes to ignore and pretend is so bad and all that. So, you know, it's just one of those things where, even if you condemn Kissinger for the stuff with Vietnam, Chile, all these other places, I still support having relations with China. It's just like when Trump had the meeting with North Korea. It's like, yeah, he's bombing seven countries, but if he wants to have peace with one in particular, I don't have a problem with that by itself. In 1970, socialist and Cuba supporter Salvador Allende was elected president of Chile, a development that worried Washington, D.C., and led the Nixon administration to approve the CIA's unsuccessful incursion of a military coup to prevent Allende's inauguration. This attempt was supported by Kissinger, and relations between the United States and Chile remained bitter throughout both Allende's and Nixon's tenures as heads of state.
Kissinger was concerned with Soviet influence in the Persian Gulf. In April 1972, amid President Nixon's re-election bid, Iraq signed a friendly treaty with the Soviet Union. The following month, during a visit to Tehran, Kissinger and Nixon told Iranian Shah Mohammad Reza Pahlavi that there would be no second guessing on his request to purchase American weapons, and the two agreed to a plan by the Shah for the United States, Iran, and Israel to support the Kurdish guerrillas in their fight for independence in Iraq. Kissinger viewed the U.S. as being unable to deploy troops to the Middle East after Vietnam and saw Iraq's Baathist regime as a possible threat to the U.S. Kissinger wrote that Shah maintained an almost naive faith in the United States due to his support by the American government in preventing a leftist government from overthrowing him in 1953. Shah's ego was inflated after being told by Kissinger and Nixon that he would be America's man in the Persian Gulf.
So when Nixon was vice president during the Eisenhower administration, that's when the U.S. helped the Shah get to power. And he basically, because at this point it's been 20 years, believed that the U.S. was just his friend, his ally. They were going to always be on his side, help him stay in power. And of course, this isn't true, because as the U.S. changes leaders, you have certain people with different views on various prominent people in the real world. And one of them was the Shah. And Kissinger realized that he could be manipulated due to being called America's man in the Persian Gulf into thinking that he was their ally who they were always going to look out for. And it's made even more ironic by the Iranian Revolution that took place a couple of years after Nixon's retirement.
I have never been a quitter. To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body. But as president, I must put the interests of America first. America needs a full-time president and a full-time Congress, particularly at this time with problems we face at home and abroad, to continue to fight through the months ahead for my personal vindication would almost totally absorb the time and attention of both the President and the Congress in a period when our entire focus should be on the great issues of peace abroad and prosperity without inflation at home. Therefore, I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow. Vice President Ford will be sworn in as president at that hour in this office. As I recall the high hopes for America with which we began this second term, I feel a great sadness that I will not be here in this office working on your behalf to achieve those hopes in the next 2.5 years. But in turning over direction of the government to Vice President Ford, I know, as I told the nation when I nominated him for that office 10 months ago, that the leadership of America will be in good hands.
In August 1974, President Nixon resigned, becoming the only U.S. president to do so, and was replaced by incumbent Vice President Gerald Ford. On Nixon's last full day as president, Nixon advised the incoming President Ford of the importance of retaining Kissinger in his administration.
On August 8th, 1974, the day he resigned, you, after that speech, you walked back with him from the Oval Office to the residence, and your parting words to him were that history would judge him as one of the great presidents. And he said, that depends, Henry, on who writes the history. 40 years have passed. Historians are still at work. How do you, 40 years later, how do you think history will treat Richard Nixon?
They will treat him as one of the seminal presidents. And it's already starting, because what was the fundamental problem for the United States? Alone among the great countries, the United States could conduct its foreign policy without a sense of foreign danger. We were protected behind two great oceans. Then, after 1945, we were so materially superior, that foreign policy really was conducted like domestic policy, that you assembled resources to meet a problem. In his presidency, in the Nixon presidency, we came up against a situation where nuclear weapons had grown to such an extent that the traditional notions of warfare were almost impossible to apply. And then you had Russia, that was both ideological and a superpower. Then you had China, which was outside the international system. You had Europe reconstituting itself. And you had America, which remained the single most powerful country and the indispensable country. But it now had to think of foreign policy differently, in this sense. Historically, we could say, if you look at American proposals, they were always with a time limit, that every problem had a solution, and within a time limit. Nixon was the first president who had to deal with a foreign policy which would never end, and which consisted, importantly, of placing America in a position where, to put it crudely, we were closer to everyone else than they were to each other. That magnified our bargaining position. Now, he understood that, and he set a pattern. You were kind enough to mention the opening to China. I think to bring about the switch of Egypt from a Soviet alliance to, in effect, an American alliance, which also happened and which revolutionized the Middle East and which set the policies for about 40 years, was in many ways as big an event. And so when that is studied, free of the animosities and disputes that characterized some of the last period of the Nixon presidency, it will be understood that he was one of the most important presidents, in especially in the foreign policy field. But Nixon had a principle that was very important and from which I personally learned quite a bit. It was very simple. It said, you pay the same price for doing something halfway as for doing it completely. So you might as well do it completely. And that sort of took you away from the hedging approach to foreign policy and obliged you to think, what are we really trying to do here? And then you could assess. So that's what I think history will increasingly say about it.
So I hope you enjoyed the first part of the Henry Kissinger documentary. For the second part, we'll look at his tenure as Secretary of State during President Ford's administration and some of his early retirement activities.